5, 4, 3, 2. Hello, listener. Hello, listener. This web series is for grown-ups, so you may hear grown-up language. There, you've been warned.
Welcome to Gay Nerd Love.
This is what we talk about when we're not doing it. I'm Archie.
And I'm Andy, and we are coming to you from Portland, Oregon, from the home studio we like to call Bamboo Studio 2.
Portland, Oregon, land, when it's correct, land of rain and grayness.
Oh, the gloom has returned.
I love the weather.
We took a vacation last week.
We were
in Las Vegas only hours after it had been the focus of the entire world, and it was an interesting trip, though. We got a lot of interesting footage for the Bad Maria Productions, known as Flippers and Balls, and...
Yes, our pinball show.
Yes. So, we are back.
But we're not here to talk about that right now. We recently saw Blade Runner 2049.
A little movie you might have heard about.
Which is a sequel. How many years after the original Blade Runner? 35-year sequel. 30 years... in the events of the film, 30 years after the events of the original movie. Mm-hmm. And, man, let me just say, because I've been reading that this movie has not been doing well financially, and I blame that on studio marketing, because it is really good. It's very good.
I would blame that on expectation as well.
Huh.
I think that, I'm puzzled by that. I think you're onto something with the marketing. I think that it's kind of over-marketed in a way. It's saturation marketed. But I also have to try to figure out how the way we interface with information now and with the world is so cultivated and curated by websites and by the bubbles that are built by algorithms that we don't even realize. So that if the only information stream you're getting is from your Facebook page, your Twitter feed, what you choose to read or what shows up in your news feed, then as a fanboy like you and I are, we would perceive that everybody in the world knows that Blade Runner is coming out.
Oh, that's a good
point.
Or
that they love it, or that it's great, or that they can't wait to see the, brand new trailer.
It's like all the nerds are aware of it already.
And so there's that nerd bubble, and I wonder if...
Nerd bubble, that's my band.
Yes, exactly. That's your pop band.
Yes.
I'm wondering if the nerd bubble kind of popped when it was released to, everyone, not just nerds, especially on probably thousands of screens. And then the publicity built it up to be, oh, this is going to be the big, huge hit that everybody's been waiting 30 years for. And turns out, apparently not.
And maybe also because of timing, because when you wait so long to do a sequel to something.
I'm wondering, what's the longest period of time between an original movie and its sequel?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know.
We don't do our homework here, so we'll have to find that out and post it later. But I also have to remind people that there's another misperception about Blade Runner for people much younger than us, and millennials are now the largest population in the United States.
Do you mean that it's science fiction?
Not just that it's science fiction, but that it was a hit.
Oh,
it wasn't.
No.
And I don't think that's just because it was way ahead of its time, which it was, and that it was so influential. I mean,
we were just before we went on air, we were watching, listening to the commentary, special feature commentary by the creative team, the production designer, special effects people, mm-hmm. on the original Blade Runner, and really it was innovative in so many ways. And a lot of times they were just like throwing things together because it looked good.
Right, and I think that because we're talking about a movie, if we talk about the original Blade Runner, we're talking about a movie that has been so, that was so influential and its influence is seen in so many things now that it's easy to lose sight of the fact that at the time in 1982, I remember seeing it in the theater in the summer of 1982, which was one of the best summers of my life in terms of movies.
I know. You know you have that moment when you see something that you've never seen before on a film.
Right.
And so you, and like your eyes get big and you're like, whoa, where
what
am
is
I? This,
this
is awesome.
I saw this when me and my parents and my niece, Cindy, we were on vacation in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. And so we just went, Cindy and I just went to see a movie. And if I remember correctly, Cindy did not like it.
Oh.
I mean, I was like, you know, all of what, 82, I would have been 16. And Cindy was 15, I think. She thought it was just kind of a downer of a movie. And it is a big downer of a movie. I was dazzled by the special effects, but the overall tone of the film and the overall feeling it leaves you with is very starkly cynical. And now people watch it and they're not struck the way we were then. In 1982, it was a very negative film.
When you talk about being, well, innovative and not science fiction, it was a noir detective story.
Right, which is what it was, I think, aiming to be and what it was marketed as. And then when the studio took it away from Ridley and re-edited it.
Ridley Scott, the director.
Right. It was made even more so by the added narration, which most people do not like.
I'm one of them.
And I'm one of the few people who actually likes it because I think that it's truer to the vision of a noir, of a film noir detective.
That I could see, you know, the Mickey Spillane thing.
Right.
But the director's recut, which I've also seen in the theater, does not have. I don't think the film suffers from not having narration.
Correct. I just think it's farther from. I think its tone gets even fuzzier then.
Okay.
But I think that the reason I'm asking that before we talk about both films, we have to calibrate the expectation. If we're talking about why it didn't do well, why the new film didn't do well, we have to remember maybe why the old film didn't do well.
Okay.
And the fact that something that at that point was ahead of its time, but also was so cynical and negative and dystopian before cynical negative dystopianism became its own subgenre. I mean, now we've got hundreds of zombie movies and dystopian. You know, it's almost like dystopianism is now the norm.
Right.
That was not true in 1982. Cyberpunk had not taken over.
Cyberpunk. I was just about to say cyberpunk because Blade Runner is credited as being one of the earliest depictions of the sort of future claustrophobic, dirty future world of cyberpunk.
Right. In fact, I was just thinking as we were
and
speaking,
neon colorful, right?
Yes. Well, neon highlighted. It's not colorful. There's neon. Neons are almost the
well. The color. The color is neon, so therefore it's
the
neon
only,
colorful.
But
right?
The only sources of light are neon, so everything else is black.
But the neon is all very colorful.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying. Neon colorful.
But the palette isn't.
I understand that.
That's what I'm saying.
Before we get into discussing the original movie, let's watch the teaser trailer from it.
From the first film.
From the first film.
Okay.
I met her at the Terrell Corporation. You know, the big boys in genetic engineering. They manufacture humans. Hell, they're so human you can't tell them from the real thing, and that's a problem. A big problem.
If I didn't care,
say you kiss me.
More than words can say.
Kind of place.
Then why do I thrill?
No choice, pal.
Trust me. See, now I'm curious how people saw that, how that struck them before they had seen the film. It's like, what the hell is this?
And this looked like before they had even settled on the Blade Runner font.
No, exactly. Yeah. I mean, until the first half of the trailer, you feel like you're watching a movie that's a remake of, like, Body Heat.
Now, I made a conscious effort to choose. I mean, I also have one for the new movie, but that's the teaser. That is not not the full trailer. So that's different. And even then, he does the narration thing. He does.
But it's not his voice.
That's not Harrison.
That's
Ford.
That's not Harrison Ford.
Right. Okay.
Which is interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. Someone who's trying to approximate him.
Yeah.
So it's before. So yeah. So they didn't use Harrison Ford. I wonder what the original font. But yeah, it's funny because I you know, from my brief time in working in movie trailers, teasers aren't meant to have that long a life.
No.
It's supposed to just
plant the seed
and get people talking.
Right.
And they're actually cutting the official trailer while the teaser's out in theaters. So
correct.
This was hard to find, that teaser. And if I had time to bump up the volume, I would have. But that's as loud as it comes off of YouTube. You can find the original teaser for Blade Runner.
And we'll post that on our social networking.
Right. So, you said we're going to post that, which we will. And...
What? What are you asking?
Well, no, I thought you were going to continue after saying that. Okay.
No. Social networking.
So, well, now we can talk about the original movie. And
right.
From that teaser, I don't remember seeing that in the theater.
I didn't.
Yeah. And I'm curious, you know, now, you know, backtracking, I'm curious what movies did it play before,
sure.
You know. It seems there's more of a tendency now than in the past to play teasers that are targeted to the audience. Like, hey, you're a nerd who likes action and science fiction, so we're going to put all action and science fiction movie trailers
right.
before your movie. I don't think that was as much the case 30 years ago.
Right. I don't think they had quite the segmental marketing, and I also think that the releases were scattered in a way that weren't quite so concentrated in seasons. I mean, they were, but not as much as they are now. They're not as carefully plotted. I mean, I'm wondering if this, you know, was shown when Empire was in theaters, or when Raiders of the Lost Ark was in movie theaters, because that was Harrison Ford's two previous films, and I don't know if they had enough of it yet. I mean, I'm assuming this would have been spring of '82, probably, when this would have shown up, right? The teaser? Sometimes the teaser comes out.
Well, yeah, because it says coming this summer, so maybe
probably
it was spring.
The same year.
Yeah, yeah.
But. Again, it's kind of like, remember that Harrison Ford made about, I think, five flops between
He
New
was
Hope.
Trying so hard to get away from being Han Solo
and
Indiana
Jones. And then he did the Raiders of the Lost Ark, and by that time it had been cemented that he was going to be an action hero. And clearly the choices he made before that were all war movies and heroes and things set that couldn't be farther from a galaxy far, far away. And so it's like he just kind of finally had to give in.
He said, yeah, right. This is what pays the bills.
But even, I mean, now this is seen as one of the great roles, or one of the roles he's most known for, correct? Is he not well known for Blade Runner the way he's known for Indiana Jones and for Han Solo? It's one of those that he's famous for. It's not the thing he's most famous for.
No, but when I was making because I run around, you know, even when we're not recording, and you do this too, you run around like making little lists in your head and entertaining thoughts and ideas about movies and characters and stuff. When I make my little Harrison Ford list in my head of roles, mm-hmm. Jake Deckard is not at the top. You know, it's Han Solo, Indiana Jones, and Jake Deckard is the third.
Rick.
Is it Rick? What did I say, Jake? Oh, that's a porn star.
I must say anything. Anyway, moving on. I think it's important to also remember that in June of 1982, when this was released...
Is Gaynor Love.
Just to remind people. There were two movies that have since become iconic in the nerd fanboy and gay nerd fanboy clubs or whatever, and that is The Thing and Blade Runner.
The Thing came out the same year, right?
It came out the same month.
Oh.
And they both flopped huge because they unfortunately happened to come out when E.T., the extraterrestrial, was sucking all the oxygen out of the room for everyone else. At least everything else kind of sci-fi.
Do you really think, I mean, do you think, I don't believe that Blade Runner would have survived even without being trounced by E.T.
I agree.
Yes.
And I think, again, that comes back to my point. This was the first of its kind, and often the first of its kind is so surprising, and if it's something that's negative or dark, rarely effective. This is the Citizen Kane of science. This is the Citizen Kane of cyberpunk. Citizen Kane, when it came out, was a flop.
Right. That's one of those famous, flops. Right.
It was cynical. It reinvented or invented so much of modern filmmaking that to go back to it now is to watch, you know, like the stem cell of movie making. Blade Runner is like that with cyberpunk, but at the time it was so stunning to people. And because people weren't that dark and cynical yet.
And people didn't want to,
see it.
Go back to Harrison Ford's his choice of roles. People weren't looking for Harrison Ford as this type of character at the time.
Right. And, okay, spoiler alert for anyone in the audience who has not actually seen the first Blade Runner movie. I'm going to say some things that may or may not give away plot points. But as we were just watching again when we watched this first film, he gets his ass kicked, not once, but twice, and is not the person who kills the antagonist in either of those situations.
That's right. I mean, for him wanting to
for
get
being,
away...
To be a hero is a very, you know...
He's more of a punching bag. He's not an action hero.
Rachel saves his ass when Leon is kicking it.
Oh, Sean Young, yeah, plays Rachel.
Right. And then Roy Batty does not kill... The character of Roy Batty, played by Rutger Hauer, who is, up until this point, going around poking the eyes out of and crushing the skulls and just a killing machine.
But he kills everyone
Everyone he encounters, and it gets to the point where it appears that he's just going to stand there and watch as Deckard plummets to his death, but he saves him.
Yeah, it's a moment, some lyrical moment of humanity where he pulls him up.
Which is a speech that Rutger Hauer improvised.
Oh.
Tears and Rain is a speech, supposedly, that Rutger Hauer came up with.
That's cool.
And then he simply dies.
Yes, his time runs out because replicants have a limited lifespan.
Maybe perhaps now in the post-Dark Knight world, that would be palatable for a mass audience. But back then, people wanted their good guys good and great and strong, flawed as they may be, and they wanted their bad guys bad, and they wanted to see the good guy kill the bad guy.
Well, yes, they were used to that.
And that's a noir thing.
That's an expectation. Oh, yes, right. For the good guy to get his ass kicked, but at the very end kill the bad guy.
But rarely did we want to see the hero. Quoting, I use hero in air quotes here.
You want to say good guy instead of hero?
Yeah, I mean, that's what they want, is they want a good guy, not just a hero. They want a good guy who is a hero. And in Blade Runner, he was not. You know, in fact, it probably was very unsettling and cynical to people. It's like, oh, he didn't kill the bad guy. He didn't kill any of the bad guys. I mean, he shot Pris after she was doing her jungle gym,
Daryl Hannah, right?
her, you know, jazzercise from hell. I mean, other than that, you know, he if you really analyze the character and his actions in the movie, he's incredibly passive. He's incredibly...
Things happen to him, right.
Even though he's supposed to be the one hunting...
He's not a dynamic character.
He's supposed to be hunting these people down, these replicants that have gone rogue and are now back on Earth. But they keep doing more things to him. Whenever he encounters them, they attack. And then... Yes, he, you know, manages to blast... Well, he blasts the two women. Blasts Zora and he blasts Pris.
Right.
And we can talk about that separately. But the men are pretty close to kicking his ass until he is saved once by another woman and then second time by fate or by time. Mm-hmm. And that's a really very poetic ending, but it's not a satisfying ending for an action movie. And even just looking at that teaser... if I were sitting in a movie theater in spring of 82, I would think, oh, I'm going to go see Harrison Ford in an action movie. I'm going to see, you know, this guy kick some ass, because I've already seen him. He's a badass in A New Hope, on the Star Wars movie. He's a somewhat of a badass in Empire Strikes Back, even though he gets, you know,
gets tortured in Empire.
But we don't expect to see him lose, or we don't expect him to not be heroic. And he's not really, he's the quote-unquote good guy, but he's not the hero, or he's not acting in the traditional heroic way. So that's what I think had a lot to do with why the film flopped. So to build on that and then make another movie, a sequel, that he's barely in. I was surprised how late he comes into that film.
Oh, sure, yeah. And we'll talk about that in 2049. But I wonder how well Blade Runner, the original, did regionally. Because in Los Angeles, I remember, it's fun, if you're from L.A. and you watch this movie, you can recognize, you know, elements of, you know,
set pieces
that take place in like Chinatown, Los Angeles, right, and especially downtown on Broadway,
right,
because the Million Dollar Theater is there and the Bradbury Building and a bunch of, but they, I remember this still image. I think it was in Cinefex or one of these special effects magazines. And there was an overhead shot of the section of downtown L.A. by Farmer's Market.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's also Farmer's Market, too, in the opening shot where he's walking around, and he said, oh, yeah, I recognize that. I can see what, you know, they did a pretty good job of replicating that section of Los Angeles,
right,
of downtown L.A. But I wonder how it did in Los Angeles, because I remember when I saw it, and I saw this dark, rainy future of LA. For some reason, I bought it immediately. This is future Los Angeles.
Right.
I don't know why. So I wonder if it did better in LA, not just among nerds, but just people who like these sort of, you know, future, you know, futuristic films than other parts.
Well, I
can't imagine it did very well in the Beltway or anything.
Or in the flyover states or whatever. I mean, because they just want to see, you know, Die Hard.
Right.
They want to see asses get kicked that are badasses by badasses. They want people who are bad kicked by badass heroes. And this movie was very much flying in the face of that. And I think the new film might be doing the same thing and might be flopping for the same reason. I guess is what I'm trying to say.
But anyone, anyone who knows the director might not have been as surprised by the tone and mood of this movie, right?
No.
Ridley Scott. I mean, he made Alien, for God's sake.
He made Alien. He made, Gladiator.
Yes.
If you want to talk about heroic figures, every time he makes a film, there has to be some kind of darkness or some kind of tragedy in elemental, you know, in the tone, if not in the plot or both.
And I'm just thinking now, the similarities between, not in story or anything, but atmospheric similarities between Alien and the original Blade Runner. You know, the
darkness.
The darkness, the smoke, the claustrophobia.
Right. The we're just here to do a job.
Yes.
Aspect.
The density of detail. In both,
as
in
well
both
as
movies.
The fantastic set design, the fantastic special effects, the visuals are always amazing. But I'm reminded that Ridley Scott's, one of his most recent films, is completely unlike that, which is The Martian.
Oh, right.
People keep thinking that Ron Howard made that, and I thought he kind of could have.
I thought it was.
While watching it,
it felt like a Ron Howard movie.
The other thing to remind people, Ridley Scott did not make the new sequel.
People know that, right?
No, a lot do, because he's the executive producer, so they see Ridley Scott and they just,
this is the director of the Arrival who did this,
right? And Arrival was a very side glance, sideway, poetic, non-traditional, sometimes confounding, oddly paced, definitely European-like movie.
Yeah, I like that, Space Squid. I liked that.
A lot of people didn't. I'm seeing online, a lot of people said, oh, yeah, I hated Arrival, too. I hated Arrival as well. That it was a mess, or that it was slow, or that, you know, that they thought that, and there's plenty of people who are, you know, saying that about Blade Runner 2049. Again, we can talk about that when we talk about that movie, but I think that if we're going to analyze any of these, I think we need to understand the phenomenon of movies were once dreams. They were once utopias. They were once idealized visions of what could be. And then when they started taking on the future, we had these utopian, beautiful places that were like palaces, like Things to Come, the movie Things to Come, or Metropolis. And Ridley Scott's Blade Runner, the first film, I believe, was the turning point for when even if you want to go back to like Logan's Run or Soylent Green, yes, there were already the seeds of dystopianism in filmmaking, but not in an everyday sense.
Maybe no.
Not so much.
I mean, like, even Westworld, you had malfunctioning humanoid.
In a park.
In a
not
park.
Not in real life.
No, it's true. In a park.
There was a sense this was happening away from the world.
But is the point that you're making that the future was very clean,
right,
and very predictable,
right,
safe kind of,
right,
thing?
And right. And I think this is the point, or one of the most influential places in cinema, where not only did the look of the future change, the look of the future reflected a deep, dark, dystopian cynicism of hopelessness, of, I mean, in Blade Runner, the planet Earth is a third world. It's everybody who can has gotten away and gotten out.
Everyone's gone to off-world who can afford it.
Right, which we see the flying dirigibles,
yes,
you know, are telling everybody, go to the place where you, yeah, can start a new life. And as one of the people in that document or that commentary track pointed out, also the sense that these are giant surveillance drones.
Oh, right.
That they're kind of always hovering over wherever Deckard is kind of going. Well, maybe they're watching
him. Yes, because the searchlights are always going.
Exactly. And so there's kind of this sense that, oh, well, the future is a ghetto.
The world is a ghetto.
And Whitey's on the moon. So, yeah, so I think that as films suddenly started showing us a future that was pretty hopeless and pretty cynical, and now we've embraced that, right? I mean, filmmaking has, and if you want to make something that's realistic about the future, you don't make it shiny.
No.
People won't buy it.
Would Blade Runner have, the original Blade Runner, have done better in the 70s? Which was much more cynical, yep, and
it could have. You know, in other words, if it had come out the same year as Soylent Green instead of the same year as E.T.
or the Andromeda, yeah, Strain, all those cynical movies from, sure, the 1970s.
Sure, I think it could have. I don't know if it would have had maybe it would have had the same kind of poetic questions about humanity and slavery, and
that was also when punk was at its peak, mid to late 70s.
When it happened,
right?
See, again, that's when it came out. We had punk before we had cyberpunk.
I know. Yes.
So therefore, there's a natural progression. The curve doesn't go in a very happy direction, though.
What do you mean?
That if you start with punk and then you go to cyberpunk and then you go to the future, the curve is down.
So,
the curve is toward chaos and destruction and hopelessness and cynicism and a few fleeting moments of beautiful poetry amidst a blighted landscape of overcrowding, cruelty, murder, death, mayhem, and no deliverance.
But punk was cynical about the future.
Right.
The music, the music itself, yes.
Punk was reflecting the times. Punk wasn't pushing them or wasn't forming them. Punk was reflecting them.
Right.
And since then, it's just become layer upon layer upon layer of that. So that now, if someone were to try to make, oh, I don't know, a movie, say, called Tomorrowland,
well,
it would fail miserably as it did.
I don't know. That's one of those, you know, Disney ride as movie things that are trying to, you know, like Pirates of
My point is that the entire culture world is eyes at it.
Right.
Now,
because what you're saying, because the entire culture now is cynical.
When everybody around me does something, I always want to step back and go, okay, wait a minute. Since everyone around me is doing this, it's the norm. But is anybody stepping back and saying, should it be? Or if it is the norm, what does that tell us about ourselves? About how dark and hopeless and cynical we are with President Trump. And with all these, President Trump didn't just happen. President Trump wasn't put in office even by Putin. President Trump was put in office because a whole bunch of people didn't vote. 46.9% of eligible voters in this country did not vote at all. 9 million people who voted for Barack Obama voted for Trump.
Okay, what's your point though?
People are hopeless. People are saying, fuck it. People are saying, screw it. Let him run it. He's already pre-corrupted. He's already pre-scandaled. He's kind of the perfect president for this horrible time that we now perceive that we live in, when in fact things are not as terrible and hopeless as they really are. But we see them that way, and our movies reflect it. That's my point.
Oh. So people were less cynical at the time that the original Blade Runner came out,
and that's like why what it they
didn't.
Saw.
Right.
They were looking at a mirror of the future, and they didn't see what they like reflected back. But now, it's like, ooh, it was so not only prophetic of the way things would become cinematically, but the way things are. Not in terms of flying cars, but
no,
in
we
terms
still,
of
we homes. Still don't have those yet. Damn it.
We have them. We just can't afford them.
Well,
as I point out to people who complain about that.
The stability thing bothers me. You know, just flying in general. I mean, I've flown since I was 4. But, you know, it's a cigar tube in the sky with wings. It's just amazing.
The idea
in the
of
air.
Flying, here's the thing people don't want to be told. You want to shake these people, and I want to shake these people and say, think about what you're asking for.
Yes.
Think of how dangerous cars are on wheels. You want them in the air?
Where there's no physical road to sort
exactly.
of help to guide the vehicle.
No, you want them falling out of the sky. In other words, the dream of flying cars is absurd.
Yeah, I agree with that.
So are people's expectations. That's my point. And so now people's expectations are dark, are cynical. People look at Blade Runner as being prophetic, not because of all the gadgets in it, because most of them aren't here yet. It's not prophetic in terms of all the businesses we see that went bankrupt since the movie came out, but it's prophetic in terms of how dark and pointless they feel the world it portrays are. And in 2049, it's darker, literally, because there's been spoiler alert, there's been this blackout that literally took out all the lights in at least the country, if not the hemisphere, you know, what, 5 years ago, I think, in the time frame.
Oh, right.
So it is literally dark.
From an EM, from an electromagnetic
pulse. Right.
So it sounds like we're going to talk about the next movie. So let us watch the teaser trailer for Blade Runner 2049.
Replicants are like any other machine. They're either a benefit or a hazard. If they're a benefit, it's not my problem. Your job once. I was good at it. Things were simpler then.
okay.
And our first response was, wow, that didn't suck. Because we kind of were afraid it would, didn't we? The way that Prometheus sucked. And
oh, you're talking about the movie. I was actually talking about the trailer.
Yeah. No, no, no.
Yeah.
I think our first response after seeing the film, which we saw in IMAX, by the way.
We did. We saw it on the largest screen possible in our local area. And
yes.
I think I did. Yeah, we did see this teaser. I can't remember which movie it came before, but I remember. And this is the second time. I got a chill. Maybe it's the music, but I got a chill watching
it's
it
an
because
effective
it's
trailer.
So well done. They just give you just enough to, you know, to excite
yep.
you. I think
I hate trailers that show too much.
The casting. I was on board with the casting. I think Ryan Gosling was very good. I was not disappointed by that. I wanted another thing I amused myself with at work was the Harrison Ford reveal. And I wanted to do a supercut of Harrison Ford revealed because it's usually his face is obscured
yep.
by some way, like by a hat or something, and then he yep. tilts his head to the camera or he
yep.
moves into the light.
Comes
right.
into the light, right. But watching that trailer, when did you expect Harrison Ford to enter the film?
Well, earlier.
Because the scene that 90% of that trailer shows us, which is the ruins of, spoiler alert, a bombed out Las Vegas, not Los Angeles.
And he's narrating.
Well, yeah, the first words in the trailer are from the original, not from the movie. They're from the original movie.
Right.
That scene that that makes up the body of that trailer happens 2 hours into the movie.
Where he moves into the light with the gun pointed at Ryan Gosling, right.
Right. And all that bright
orange. Spoiler. Did we say spoiler alert? Spoiler alert for everything we're about to say about. Oh, okay.
Yes. If you think that we're going to be able to talk about this movie and not reveal shit, then just, you know, go see it and come back and listen to the rest. Almost all of the trailer is bright orange.
Right.
But the last scene we see of him walking through downtown L.A., like 10 seconds of it, is the first 2 hours of the movie. It's that dark L.A. It's that dark L.A., not a sign of Harrison Ford.
Right. You're saying that teaser opens with the end of the film, basically.
Yeah.
The last act
of the film. Right.
Right.
So I think that may have set people up to think they were going to see a Harrison Ford film. I mean, he's got co-billing with Ryan Gosling there above the title.
Well,
I would have expected more than 15 or 8. I'm sure some nerd somewhere has already clocked the literal amount of time that Harrison Ford is in the movie.
Harrison Ford's screen time?
Probably barely in double-digit minutes.
And
in a film that's already about 15 or 20 minutes too long.
What it's like, I know that like other movies where an iconic or memorable character appears only briefly. Earlier in the film, no reference to them by like showing pictures or flashback
right.
clips. Or anything. They did none of that.
No, I actually thought I approve of as a filmmaker.
I agree.
Right
they
now.
Say they saved
was,
it. I agree.
I mean, there was that Edward James Olmos scene, which just to me kind of seemed shoehorned into the movie to get him in there.
Yes,
which was unfortunate. I really wanted him part of the movie, part of the action, part of the plot. It just seemed perfunctory to me.
Make him the head of something or part of some department.
Have him running.
Or something.
Have him
yeah.
sitting behind a desk. Give him the part that was played by Robin.
Robin Wright. Yeah.
Give him that part.
Training Blade Runners, right?
Right. I mean, I.
Yeah. Why didn't almost have Robin Wright's part? That would have been good. And then when he's spoiler alert when he's killed off, instead of you know the way she was.
Right.
That would have had
right.
more impact because
totally.
we already have a history with this character.
Maybe he didn't want to do that much. Maybe there was a reason for
he's
that.
He was tired. Fuck it.
It felt perfunctory.
Yeah.
And that's too bad because he's one of the most interesting characters in the first film and he's barely in the movie. But everybody remembers him. He's just indelible.
Oh, with that. Oh, and he had the eye, right? The
heterochromic. Yeah, he has like one brown eye, one blue eye. And
did he? Wasn't he the only character who spoke city speak in that? You know, that sort of mashed up language.
Right, I think so.
Language, and so.
Well, he's also.
We don't hear
of,
it in the future in his current movie.
No, we don't. But there's this kind of hybrid quality to his character because you've got a Hispanic actor. But he's done up almost in Fu Manchu makeup as if he's partially Asian.
Right.
And kind of in this zoot suit looking kind of garb. that I'd be curious to see how much fan fiction has been written about him, because his character is so much more interesting and so much more deserving of more material that I'm sure people must have gone.
By then, definitely. There must be a whole world we're unaware of.
Right.
A whole world of
deep, we're not deep nerd on this.
Post Blade Runner fan fiction.
Right. So I'm wondering. So again, so what I'm trying to get back to is, if the expectation was already being laid out there for this was going to be a Ryan Gosling Harrison Ford movie, instead of a Ryan Gosling movie that Harrison Ford comes into in the last act, then I think just in terms of expectation, that's going to be a fanboy letdown. And that the word of mouth on this movie is going to be neutral to negative rather than, oh, yeah, it was Blade Runner and Harrison Ford was back and, you know, and la, la. No, again, dark as people are and cynical as they are, there's still this desire to see them kick ass.
And, well, and then 30 years later, also because Ridley Scott's reputation has been, you know, because he had some bombs, but when he hits it, I mean, he hits it, you know.
Martian, out of the park.
Right. And so even in that teaser, they say Ridley Scott's name first, and then the actual director of the movie comes second.
Right. A name that most people don't recognize.
No, and Rival didn't do well, did it?
It did okay.
It did okay, right.
But I think that's because, again, the expectation for a movie.
We're going to see a Ridley Scott movie starring Harrison Ford, right? A sequel to.
Right. And I'm talking about Arrival. Arrival, people weren't expecting a kick-ass action hero because it's a woman movie and it's a movie about aliens that doesn't look like it's going to be.
It's a movie about feelings.
Exactly. Exactly. And Blade Runner 2049 is a movie about feelings.
It is.
One of the things that I think is most effective about casting Ryan Gosling is the ability he has to do what I heard called eye acting.
All those dreamy
where he just kind of moves his eyes in a certain way, and he doesn't have to speak lines. You can tell he's either sad or he's angry or he's changing from sad to angry or whatever. That he really can do well, I think, to the point where you can almost kind of, what you just said, kind of laugh at it. Mm-hmm. But I think that was appropriate and good, especially for a character who is, and I don't think this is a spoiler alert because it's established right up front, he's playing a Blade Runner who is, right from the minute, aware of the fact that he is
a
replicant.
Right.
There's no question.
He doesn't even have a first name. He has a serial number or something.
Until he's given a name, yes. So this movie is about deeper things than action movies are, which is what I'd expect Denis Villeneuve to do. You know, the same way that Gravity was not a movie about, you know, getting into a space shuttle and shooting Russian satellites down. It was a movie about feelings. But it did better, I think, because there was a lot more action in it. But there's a lot of quiet in Blade Runner 2049, wouldn't you say?
I really enjoyed that, too, because it could have gone another way and said, oh, well, we got to give. Because
That's the suckiness we were afraid of.
Well, again, about the marketing, the trailers we saw before this movie began were all action, were like futuristic action films, most of them, anyway. You know, a Pacific Rim sequel and...
Right.
The Last Jedi was also there, too?
That, a Transformer movie.
Transformer movie, right.
You know, whatever kind of movies are aimed at fanboys.
And then it's just like, okay, forget everything we just showed you. This movie is not that.
And I don't think people got that. I think they resisted that expectation. They didn't realize they were going to see a $150 million art film.
I thought the theater would have been packed.
It wasn't.
It wasn't.
And this was opening weekend, was it not?
It was, yes. It opened Friday. We saw it Sunday.
Right. So I don't know. I mean, I don't want the whole episode to be about why did Blade Runner 2049 fail. But I think that the answer to that one question leads to a lot of other more interesting questions as well about the movie itself.
Now, when we say fail,
box office fail,
yeah,
not artistic
sales,
fail.
Artistic, you know, it succeeded, you know, well beyond my expectations.
Whereas Prometheus made buco box office, but I think is a mess artistically, and that is directed by Ridley Scott.
Fail in terms of, because my understanding is that. In this day, that a film has to make three times its budget to be considered a hit, at least financially,
a hit
for the studio, and so this is not doing it.
No. It'll be lucky if it makes its money.
And I think I don't think it's just audience expectation. I mean, that's a huge part of it. But also, again, I go back to the marketing. I think this movie was mishandled marketing-wise.
Or misperceived in its marketing?
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's possibly true. The only reason I think that we're talking so much about this is that it really will impact the future of what movies get greenlit, what directors get huge budgets to make movies, which is why you end up with movie after movie after movie of Transformer being made, despite the fact that's basically the same movie over and over. Because it makes tons of money, and that's really what they're... It is a business.
Right.
So I don't think we're going to see a lot more Blade Runner 2049 type movies, unfortunately. As a result, if this completely tanks, you know how every year there's one movie that has either high expectations that aren't met or that just everybody laughs at as being kind of the ultimate flop of the year, the Ishtar of its year, the Godzilla of its year. There's always one movie that everyone just perceptively...
Well, I hope
like Waterworld, which actually broke even, but people still think of it as being one of the greatest flops in movie history. But it actually did break even.
Well, artistically, I think it's a flop because that movie's a mess. But
right, but I'm just saying the perception of it.
Sure,
I'm wondering if this is going to be that movie. Because
I really
it's
hope
so
not. I think it's going to happen. Maybe not take as much time as it did with Blade Runner, but later on, people are going to come around and say, let me just watch it and say, oh shit, I wish I'd supported it when it came out.
I appreciated what it was
right?
saying and doing at the time.
This is really good.
I think there are things to criticize about the movie that are not misperceptions.
No.
I do think that it has a woman problem.
What do you
Both
mean?
Movies do.
You mean writing for women?
Fails the Bechdel test.
Oh,
you
right,
never
right.
have two women in a scene alone talking about something other than a man.
Okay.
All the women seem to perform specific roles in their relationship to something other than... They don't seem to have their own lives.
Are you thinking that aspect would keep women away from seeing
the
movie?
No. I'm talking about the movie itself. I'm talking about even if we're going to now close the question of, okay, why is it flopping and just look at the movie artistically?
Mm-hmm.
Like you, I came out of the theater thrilled that it wasn't a big mess and appreciating all the visuals, appreciating a lot of it. The more I thought about it, the more troubled I became by several things in the film, which may not have to do with its artistic visuals or things that are about filmmaking. So that's what I'm trying to say.
All right. Well, go into that because I can... Because I'll probably agree with some of the things you said. Because right now I'm still kind of a little awash in the glow of it. Hey, it didn't suck.
It's why I wanted to see the film a second time before we talked today, but I didn't get around. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to. I do want to see it again to kind of confirm or
in 3D.
Right. I want to see it in 3D just because it's so dazzling visually, and I still think it's dazzling visually, but the women are all two dimensional or less. The main antagonist is a white woman who is almost non-dimensional. I don't feel like there's anything going on except that she's a female Terminator. In fact, I felt like I was watching the character from the Terminator movie about the female Terminator. Was that Rise of the Machines?
Yes, right.
Had just been transplanted with the new hairstyle.
But she had the Claire glare.
She had the Claire glare. She did. All she did is look at things and basically emotes, I hate you so much, I'm going to now kill you. She is literally a machine.
Right.
She's not a person. In a movie that seems to be about humanity, that seemed weird. And the other, even the wonderful Robin Wright wasn't given a lot to do with that role. It's a really one-dimensional role. She's just kind of a plot point. And the other character that's a big plot point or even spoiler, who is kind of the key, by the end of the film, the key to the film, she is just kind of presented as a thing rather than a person. Even though she's kind of this golden child or whatever.
Are you talking about Rachel?
No.
Oh, you're talking about
the daughter.
The daughter, right. Oh, right.
She's not got much in the film to do as a person.
So it's a dude's movie, is what
you're
saying. It's
a dude's movie, even though it's done in this very airy-fairy poetic kind of way that I love. I love the style of the film. But feminist-wise, I was posting online, I'd really love to see a deep feminist take on this movie, because, and then I found one, and I was like, yeah, it, feminist-wise, it's kind of eviscerated. And there is nary a sign of any people of color in this movie. It's as if we were joking
about Blade Runner. That's the way it was in the first movie.
Well, I'm going to point that out as well. Blade Runner is Lily White. And we're talking about the future.
In the future, there are only Latinos and Asians.
Apparently.
And white people.
Right. I mean, it's like, where are the black people?
We ate them.
I guess. Or they, blacks on the moon. I don't know. Did they get their own planet?
They put them all on the moon.
They got their own planet. Well, we were saying, well, are they all now, you know, I mean, because we've already made it clear in Blade Runner 1, we'll call it, that replicants are the new slaves.
Right.
And they're all Aryans. I mean, how many of the characters?
So the replicants.
Zor's got red hair, but Pris has bright blonde hair, and she's white as Lily White. Roy Batty is Lily White. Leon is just a big dummy, but he's Lily White.
So
Deckard, the replicant we now know is a replicant. Spoiler alert.
Deckard was chasing down runaway slaves.
Yes, and he was himself a slave because he didn't even realize he was a slave. So yeah. So I mean. We were laughing about it when we were watching just today that final cut that we were watching just to listen to the doc commentary track. I think I spotted two black people in the background who were like showgirls in the taffy part, you know, the nightclub. That's not my kind of place, Mr. Deckard. Other than that, this is incredibly Lily White movie. And 2049 was appallingly so. That we could go 30 years and the future seems to be just as
well, that they're still in Los Angeles and the
oh, come on. Yeah,
right. And there are no, because I mean the actual, I mean, and I understand it's the future, but the actual demographic of Los Angeles is just, I think there are more Latinos
right
in the population than anyone else.
Well, by the year 2050 something, white people are going to be statistically a minority, and by the year 2075, if current trends continue, the largest minority group in the United States is going to be Asian.
Mm.
That's a lot thing, something that people, a lot of people do not know. Regardless of that fact, where are the black people in these movies?
Hasn't that just
And I don't mean to sound like a punch card liberal here.
Well, no, but hasn't that been a sort of a general thing about futuristic movies? Science fiction is that they don't expect black people to be, non-white people to be around.
Exactly. And I wonder about my black nerd friends, and there are lots of black nerds, there are lots of blurds, Larry Wilmore being one of the most outspoken of them, who say, you know, I'm sick and tired of going to movies and not seeing my own people. It's like, what is it?
I think Richard Pryor made a joke about that. They don't expect us to be here.
Exactly.
I wonder what happened.
I think it's worthy of exploration. Now, in one of those prequel shorts,
yes,
that
part
were made.
Now about the before you go into that, about the marketing, the pre-marketing of this film,
yeah,
is that they made these direct to YouTube prequel shorts of the film
that aren't in the film at all. In fact, they happened before the timeline of the film.
Right, it sort of get you. They're made by guest directors, sort of bridge the original film to the
one
current
is anime.
One. Right.
So yeah, they kind of there is a black person in one of those.
Sure, is he a major character? I don't remember.
No, he's just kind of there. But you know, in a short film, how much character can you build? But
I was the brother in the background.
One of them is a Jared Leto, short is about Jared Leto's character.
Now Jared Leto is Wallace, who took over Terrell Corporation
after Blackout,
right?
And who is not in Blade Runner 2049 as much as I expected.
That's
either.
Another thing that it was surprising is that because Jared Leto's career is hot right now,
right?
Their expectation was that he would be more prominent in the new movie, and he is not.
And his character is kind of there, but it's vague. I would say that I would ding it artistically and story wise for how fuzzy his role in the film is. I mean, was it fuzzy because they're trying to make this a franchise and so they don't want to give away everything.
Maybe.
You know?
I mean, he's going to be like... He does as much as he can with what they give him, I think, though.
Right. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the script.
Oh, sure.
I'm saying the story-wise, were they not giving us because they wanted to give us more later? I mean, I got more about his character and his function in the short movie that we saw that was the prequel short than I did in the entire film 2049. It was clearer in that short what he was up to than it was in the movie.
Oh, and that just made me think. We will post in the description to this episode the links to the three prequel shorts for Blade Runner 2049.
I think those are helpful to watch.
Right.
And especially in the point about Jared Leto's character. That short that he is in.
I would agree. It gives you more information about him than the whole movie does.
And gave him more to play and gave him more of something to do. I mean, think of how few moments or lines Eldon Terrell has in the first film, but how indelible he is.
Right.
As a person.
How deeply do we want to go into specific detail about 2049? Because I do want people to go out and see it, right?
So. I would encourage people to see it for sure, because I think it's a visual wonder. I think it's interesting and provocative, and there's some great performances in it and some beautiful visuals and all that.
A worthy sequel to Blade Runner.
Yes.
It was worth the wait for me.
I think so. Yeah, I do.
But you were about to. I don't think you were finished about all your little nitpicks or your criticisms about it.
I think that's all I have in terms of nitpicks. But now let's talk about the good stuff. Let's talk about what's great.
Okay.
There's some incredible visuals in this movie. There are also a lot of callbacks in this movie that aren't completely eye-rollingly obvious, and I give him credit for that. Right down to the final moments of the film, which I think are probably the most obvious callbacks. Right down to the music cue that's playing underneath them.
Oh, right.
The Tears in Rain music is playing during what is the equivalent of the Tears in Rain moment in 2049.
Oh,
big spoiler alert.
Right, right.
There.
And the, there's a visual callback. I mean, Rachel, we see a duplicate of Rachel.
Yeah, and let's talk about how well that works or doesn't work in terms of the technology, because being effects geeks. The instant thing we did was we saw her and we sat up in our chairs in the theater, not because we love Rachel, but because we wanted to see the CGI, right?
Did I sit up? I didn't
know. You did.
Oh, yeah. Because we know that Sean Young is much older and does not look like that anymore. So how are they going to pull this off? Is it going to be like Tarkin and Leia in The Force Awakens?
Yeah, I can never even remember that movie. I'm trying to
forget. No, it's Rogue One.
Yeah, it's in Rogue One.
Rogue One, at the end of Rogue One. And they...
Yeah, we see old Leia. which again, I wanted to see...
Old Rachel?
I wanted to see old Rachel. I was really angry at the movie, that the plot of the movie had her dead.
I did want to see her, too. And was it because Sean Young's too wacky? Or did
she offered.
Oh.
There were specific talks. She said she was more than interested to come in, you know, even in one scene or even in some sort of. I mean, she didn't have to be alive in the movie's action, but we could have seen something of her other than that weird photograph that didn't look anything like her.
No.
And then that weird CGI version of Rachel, not John Young, but of the Rachel from the first film, which came closer than the Leia and Moff Tarkin CGI, but there's still something not quite right.
Right, and
it still looked like a CGI projection.
I was saying after we left the theater, because that's one of the things that we latched on to, as far as effects wise, and I think the difference between that and in the end of Rogue One, was that those were fully generated CGI faces, if my recollection's correct, but this one they mapped Sean Young's features in CGI over a real actress's face, and so there were some more subtleties they were able to capture than if they had rendered it completely.
Right. It wasn't an entire wireframe.
So it was more convincing.
It was more convincing, but in a movie about robots, dead eye isn't necessarily going to be a bad thing.
And for some reason, they always want to do it in close up to say, "Ooh, look what we did! Look how."
The other help was the one scene that we see the retro Rachel or the new Rachel or whatever it's in a lighting that's very similar to the first film, but it's also very side lit.
Right.
Whereas Tarkin and Leia are both in brightly lit scenes, and that's why we see how doll like and fake.
Oh, that's
they
a good
look.
Point.
So that was wise of them to put it not in like laboratory lighting, but to have it in that kind of noir, orangey, you know, shadowy light.
And that's a big reveal when, at the end of the film, when Deckard is being tortured by Wallace. Well, you know, be tortured by proxy.
By his proxy, right.
And I love the whole... Let's talk about the insight. I mean, leading up to that, let's talk about the whole... The inside of the Terrell building,
Wallace building?
Isn't it the Terrell? Didn't he move into the Terrell building? It's still the Terrell building, but Wallace moved in.
Okay,
right?
I think so.
Because the building was all blacked out, but everything else was still lit.
I think you're right.
So, the lighting in there with all the water, water reflections.
The set design and the lighting design were just orgasmic.
Yes.
For me, it's kind of like one of those things where I don't care how terrible this movie is, I would still be loving at least these elements of it. And they really are fantastic.
Very much like Blade Runner. A lot of the shots in Blade Runner were...
There were
callbacks. The first word that came to mind is frameable.
Right.
I mean, you could just like capture a still and put it on a wall. It's so gorgeous.
Yeah.
And this movie, Blade Runner 2049, does the same thing. It creates some wonderfully images.
It has its own style, too. Whereas the rooms in the Terrell building, the noir rooms or Terrell's bedroom that we go into, you know, toward the end or whatever, are all very cluttered and very dark. In the first film. The Wallace rooms are very zen-like.
Very open, very sparse.
Open, very huge, very sparse, stone and water. And it's a completely... Obviously, Wallace is a very different kind of genius.
Oh, if we didn't mention it, Wallace is blind, by the way.
Right. And I think that the simplicity and the starkness of the design makes sense.
So he doesn't bump into shit.
Right. I mean, even though he's got this cybernetic...
All those
little clicking floating
stones,
little stones that kind of follow around like little cameras.
That's a nice touch.
It's nice, but in other words, there's a lot that's really thought through in this movie that has the visuals not only making sense for the world of the movie itself, but to reflect back upon the first film. In fact, it wasn't until I saw Blade Runner, the original film, the second time recently, just this morning, that I realized that there was reflected water-like light in the Terrell building.
Ah.
In that first scene with Rachel. I had forgotten that. So it's like, oh, well, no wonder it's brought back and ramped up for the new film. Again, those are the nice kind of callbacks that aren't obvious callbacks. They're stylistic callbacks. And I'll give Denis Villeneuve, you know, big props for doing that without making it kind of groan-inducing. Where it's like, oh, yeah, this is supposed to be that. No, they're much more subtle.
I remember him in doing the promo for this movie saying that that whenever possible, they built everything that you see in the film, and kind of like a Christopher Nolan,
right?
And didn't rely upon
People walking around on a green screen.
CGI. So you really, it gives the actors. It gave more reality,
To see the exact opposite of that, see some of the most horrible parts of the Independence Day sequel.
Oh.
Remember that stuff that looks so badly green screened? It looks like they literally were the only people standing on a green screen stage.
Yeah, I barely remember that movie.
With all this shit behind it, especially the scene with the general, the guy who died recently afterwards.
Oh, I can't even think of his name.
I can't even think of his name. Anyway.
Robert Loggia?
Yes. The scene with Robert Loggia will give you an example of what can go wrong, even with either that or they ran out of money. But that is what you get when you try and do everything, you know, green screen, all polygons. I love that there are directors that are out there that have a lot of clout or might have a lot of clout, like Nolan, like Villeneuve, who are going back and using built sets, using built props, using
models
like in Interstellar. I think that I appreciated Interstellar twice as much after seeing the making of, where I realized how much of that stuff was analog.
It's so satisfying to learn that something you thought was CGI was actually built on stage. It was a physical thing.
Well, and that's what was interesting about listening to this apparently 30th anniversary DVD commentary track by Trumbull and some of the people who did the matte painting and set design of the original Blade Runner, all talking about, well, you know, we had to do this by building it. We had to do this by doing this or doing that.
We grabbed pieces of other sets and then made them work for this scene.
We grabbed walls from My Fair Lady that weighed tons because they were made out of plaster.
But they were really tall and they looked
tall
good.
And beautiful and they worked. Whereas, yeah, you can do anything with a whole bunch of polygons, but when you're starting from complete scratch like that, you're not necessarily going to come up with the best set design. Compare the sets of Star Trek the Motion Picture and Star Trek II The Wrath of Khan, which had a quarter of its budget. They had to do so much creativity with the second movie. The first movie, plenty of money, but it all looks like you're in somebody's, you know, oddly covered in carpet or stainless. It just looked all very sterile and uninteresting.
And you know, the original Blade Runner, they didn't have much to go on. I mean, they had to create this world. And, well, they had the vision of Ridley Scott.
And Sid Mead. Who was also in that commentary track we listened to.
Yes, who designed the vehicles and things like that, some elements of the
Void Comp machine.
Right. And I also appreciated in the new movie, Blade Runner 2049, they did a similar thing that Rogue One did.
Which is
Star Wars War Rogue One, is that they acknowledge that there was a pre-existing storyline, mm-hmm. and they gave you enough callbacks or enough references to the original storyline, but they didn't get lazy with it,
right?
And keep bringing in things and saying, "Oh, remember this thing from the original movie? Wasn't that
or
cool?
They,
remember this thing?"
Or
from the
they
original?
Didn't get too consciously patronizing.
Actually, Rogue One was a prequel, so but still. They could have, you know, reminded you. Oh, you know, of the film that preceded it.
Right. Which compared to while we were on vacation, we just happened across one of the prequels of Star Wars and started hate watching it, and we had so much fun hate watching it.
Oh, you know, I almost wish we had recorded that.
It was funny. It really was.
We might do that from time, because, you know, that's a thing now on YouTube where people...
This riff track stuff?
Well, yeah, they call it, watch with us as we watch this movie, and they just talk about it. We might do that. It sounds kind of lazy.
Well, whenever
it might
finally,
be funny.
When I find my copy of Can't Stop the Music, we can do that. I still have a dream that I will find that someday on DVD.
Yeah, so they call back to the original Blade Runner, but in
sometimes
a...
it's just a music cue.
In a way that serves the story... this film still stands on its own. You don't have to have seen Blade Runner to see this film. I'm saying that. Do you think that's true?
I guess I believe it or not. It's probably the most obvious question, and I hadn't really thought about it too deeply. And now the more I think about it, the more I'm like, I don't know about that.
Because
the whole plot seems to revolve around what happened to Rick and Rachel and what it means. I mean, I think I'm tipping now back toward you. The more I think about it, I agree that I think that you can watch this movie without having done your homework or having seen prequel.
Let's keep that note in our mind. Now, you know, we're prejudiced, obviously, having seen the first film, I don't know how many times, but trying to keep that note in your mind and as an objective viewer, when we see it again in 3D, mm-hmm. Does this movie stand on its own without knowing?
Yeah, that will be the operative question going in.
And anybody who's listening to this or anybody who's seen... Oh, by the way, subscribe to our YouTube channel. We're going to have all our social media at the end of the show. But you can see Bad Maria Prods on YouTube, and that'll take you right to our channel of all our videos. But this movie... That sort of orangey look towards the last act. I loved all that. You know,
it's, I did.
It's,
it
in,
a nice,
it's Las Vegas.
It was, yeah. Well, it's, yeah. So we get kind of this desert feel rather than this urban blackout feel.
And that was smart to use it in the teaser to say, hey, this is not Blade Runner. You know,
this is something new, mm-hmm. even if you're going to have to wait 2 hours to get to it. But yeah, I agree that, that it has its own. I mean, it still has the rainy LA, but it's not the same rainy LA, and it's not the same effects, and it's not the same. But yet, we do get that whole final act that's not LA. That's this, spoiler alert, it's Las Vegas, but it's a deserted Las Vegas because of a dirty bomb, apparently.
Right.
Which is probably like, I started thinking to myself, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. There's the other short film I wish that we'd been able to see of what was the story behind that. Was it Islamists? Was it religious fundamentalist Christians? Because, I mean, where would you want to bomb if you were a religious fanatic and you thought that this was the den of ultimate, you know.
That's my other band, Dirty Bomb.
Dirty Bomb, that's right. B-O-M. What was the backstory on that?
Yeah.
And I guess it would make sense that that would be the perfect place for Deckard to go and hide with Rachel. But, I mean, that's why the immediate thing I did when I came home after the movie was to see if somebody had done a novelization. Oh. I would really like to hear a backstory on that. And maybe, you know, fan fiction people are out there doing it already. Now that they have this end point, they can write the stories between.
Now, having said what I said about this movie being able, you know, standing by itself, I think this movie and someone in the audience would appreciate it, a viewer would appreciate it more having seen the original.
The three shorts.
And the three shorts. Because the original does not settle the question of whether or not it actually towards the very end. I mean, call me slow, call me young, whatever. I didn't entertain the question of whether or not Deckard was a replicant.
The first time you saw it.
The first time I saw it.
Yeah, I don't. Right. I don't either. Even though the clues are there.
The clues are definitely there. But the second film makes it very clear. I mean, they say it that he's a replicant.
Right.
Gosling says it.
Well,
to
and
him.
So does Deckard. So. There's this kind of part of me that's going, oh, God, I want to see the moment when Rick Deckard finds out, holy shit.
Right, and how does that change his life?
And that's key to the very big reveal.
Yes.
In 2049 that I'm not going to spoil here, that I think is interesting and worth seeing the film to get to. In fact, it's unfortunate that Harrison Ford is 75 years old and perhaps they will finally perfect the Rachel technology so that they could actually make... I would not mind to see a prequel movie between Blade Runner and Blade Runner 2049 now.
Come here. No, I was going to say that we're just like psychically linked that we don't... without having discussed it before we went on air, we are not mentioning the big reveal at the end of the movie, right? We just know not to do that.
We just know. Come here.
Come here, baby.
Yes. So, yeah, I mean, so please... even though I've got plenty of, you know, political and artistic nitpicks about this movie, go see it.
And tell people to go see it because
you want to see more movies like this rather than the next Transformer film. Don't go see that, please.
No.
Tell everybody not to. Block the theaters. Have a sit in front of the doors. Stop people from seeing
movies. Go see every Transformer movie. Go see any Transformer movie before that one. You will have seen all Transformer movies. But We talked a lot about we've given a lot of attention to the visuals, you know, the mood and the atmosphere of this film. But let's talk about the writing. I mean, putting your criticisms about the way women characters written, I thought the writing was very well as far as serving the story. I mean, what came out of the characters' mouths was believable.
It wasn't too, because that's one of the criticisms I think you can make of the first film. There are a couple places, especially. Oh. You know,
with the narration,
not just the narration, but the hard boiled police commissioner is
right.
Just kind of speaking in noir-esque, talk about Beauty and the Beast. You know, it's like
he literally talks out of the side of his mouth.
Literally out of the side of his mouth. The dialogue is good. There's a lot of moments where there isn't dialogue, and they trust the actors to make the scenes work. And I think that's a combination of the writing and the director trusting the actor.
And
we need more of that in films.
Didn't we, maybe I said it and you agreed, but didn't we also say that the story more than once leads you towards an obvious conclusion and then doesn't go there?
Yeah.
It makes a right turn. And you're just thank God it did not do this obvious thing that I was predicting.
In fact, there was this dread building in me during the film that I was like, okay. In fact, I think I told you a version of it.
You did.
I said, I'm going to scream if blank, blank, blank turns out to be true.
Right.
And the film was like doing all these things to kind of hint at that. And I'm like going, oh, even though I'm loving the visuals and everything here, it's going to go. And oh, thank God.
Yes.
I don't think I was thrilled so much as relieved it didn't go there.
Yeah, there's a few oh, thank gods for me in that. It's like, oh, you know, this could have been, again, this could have been lazy writing just because it had a, you know, sort of a built-in nerd audience anticipating this movie. Because I remember reading the online, the anticipation for this film was very high.
Which may also be why it's not doing well. It could be that the people who anticipated a different film or anticipated too high, and that the initial word of mouth was negative. They came out of the theater angry, or they came out of the theater disappointed. And so the first people, if you think about it virally, that if they come out of the theater and they're going to tell at least 10 people what they thought, if the 10 people they tell are, oh my God, this is so amazing, go see it, or if they are, then every person who saw the movie the first time in, like, say, Friday, may have a tenfold effect on thumbs down or thumbs up.
Is it like a game of telephone?
Yes.
Except it goes down. It's a downward thing.
Viral can work both ways.
Okay.
And so I'm wondering if the initial downwardness of the indications of box office, or the whispers of flop already, which now happen within hours of movies' releases.
They're on their phones.
Because of the fact that people are so pre-programmed for certain expectations that the marketers tell them that they have to do in order to make them happy and see the movie, but on the other hand may end up be guiding them toward an expectation of a movie they're not going to get. It's not going to be Harrison Ford for 2 hours and 30 or 40 minutes, you know, shooting at bad guys. It's going to be a grizzled, broken down, hiding Harrison Ford that we don't see after about, I think, an hour and 45 minutes.
And I'm thinking, like, come on, people. It's, I mean, just time-wise, Harrison Ford is not a young man.
No,
what are you expecting him to do?
And he did most of his stunts in the first one. He's not going to do all the stunts in this one. And, by the way,
he had
a terrible time when he was making Blade Runner. For years, he wouldn't even discuss it.
Howard Stern said, just aside, Howard Stern said, Harrison Ford always delivers his lines like he's tired.
He does. He does. I think he's the Democrats' Clint Eastwood.
Right. That's good.
You know, he has a kind of squinty, kind of like. Well, I mean, going all the way back to Han Solo. Han Solo is kind of, you know, roped into this rebellion.
Yes.
All he is like, I'm just giving you a ride.
Right.
You know, and I got debts to pay. Yeah. You know,
that's because droids don't rip your arms off when they
exactly. See, and that's what we love about him. So I was actually kind of hoping for that movie. I was hoping for the movie. This is the reason I absolutely one of the other reasons I absolutely hated Force Awakens. We did not get that opportunity to see what an old 70-year-old Han Solo. I'm tired. I can't keep joining your clans.
Right.
We just got a brief moment, and then he got stabbed in the stomach by his own son for reasons that defy logic, and a murder that happens while everybody who cares about him is off screen, and just people who have barely met him are on screen.
You're making me
the
angry.
You're getting me angry again. The people who wrote that. Yes, you can hear me, can't you? I can't believe Lawrence Kasdan put his name on that.
I know.
So maybe it's a backdoor compliment to Harrison Ford. I wanted to see them give him the chance to be more than an action star, but to really do some acting like he did in Mosquito Coast, which I am told is his favorite, is his personal favorite.
Mm.
Nobody saw that film.
I saw it. It was good.
In the theater.
Right.
It got like no box office hardly at all. Even though River Phoenix is in that movie, Harold Mirren is in that movie. So I was really kind of hungry, and I was a little disappointed that we only got Harrison Ford playing a plot point instead of Harrison Ford really giving us a performance. But go see it. It's still worth seeing.
It is.
It's fun.
And with that,
regardless of everything,
we'll just say you like the movie. Honey, would you say unequivocally that you enjoyed the movie and people should go see it?
I can't say anything unequivocally. Don't you know that by now? You've known me for 2.5 fucking years.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, I think that
do your maybe best.
What you should do is you should release two versions of this. You should release a version of this episode that completely edits out all of my picking and knowing and planning, and you can just say this is the positive review.
Blade Runner 2049.
No, I think I have monologues. It's easier than that. You can just cut whole sections out of this episode, and then you can say, "Oh, this is the more complicated version. This is like the director's cut, like what Ridley Scott did." Insert running unicorn scene here.
Oh, don't get me started. Well, that ends this
another
episode.
Fun hour of nitpicking and complaining and complicated criticism and equivocalness.
Well, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. All our social media presences will be run at the end of the show.
So yeah, like all those or post to those, and don't just necessarily sign up for them. We really do want feedback, believe it or not. Our opinions are open to not only, you know, questioning, but also, hey, did you notice this? Or, hey, you know, I thought that. Or, hey, you're full of shit. Here, did you ever think of this?
Yeah, bring up something we hadn't thought of. And
send us links to things that we haven't found. That's what
I
love about the web.
We will respond.
We will.
Again, with, you know, where we are on social media, we don't do a lot of updating because we're busy.
We have lives. We don't get paid for this shit.
But if you write to us, we will definitely write back.
Totally, yes. But you know what our motto is? Well, listen at the end of the show.
So until next time, I Gaynard love you, Andy.
I Gaynard love you. I love that you love me for Gaynard reasons.
So again, viewer, here's our social media presences at the end of the show. And then we'll close out the show. Gay Nerd Love is a project of Bad Maria Productions.
We really don't have to do this.